The things that I'm going to tell you about today are horrendous, but the flip side of it is some of the things that the New World Order and the Illuminati know, if they were put to good use, would be fantastic. But if you saw what I've seen, it would make you angry that these people are taking what could be used for the elevation of mankind, and they're using it to enslave us.
Evil men have already divided up the world into regions, and they've got it all planned. They want to rule the world. Their goal is to reduce the population to 500 million, with a few of them as the right, you know, the elite get to rule the world. God has plans for the world, and so does Satan. And Satan's plan is no people here, maybe just a few, and a one world government. The Bible says perilous times shall come. The people will be fierce, despisers of those that are good. Christians are going to be absolutely hated.
Its task will be to develop an overall strategy for America in this period when really a new world order can be created. It's a great opportunity. It isn't just a crisis.
We know the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong. Do you not think an angel rides in the whirlwind and directs this storm?
But I do have one question. During the crisis, or any time that you're aware of, has the Federal Reserve or Treasury participated in any gold swaps arrangements?
The Federal Reserve does not own any gold at all. We have not owned gold since 1934.
Again. Not with these ways, which hither ye have brought from regions where I reign.
Which passages of Scripture should guide our public policy? Should we go with Leviticus? Which suggests slavery is okay, and that eating shellfish is an abomination. Or we could go with Deuteronomy, which suggests stoning your child if he strays from the faith. Or should we just stick to the Sermon on the Mount, a passage that is so radical that it's doubtful that our own Defense Department would survive its application?
Readings have told me, for what it's worth, that some of us will be able to have ascended abilities, I mean full-on ascended abilities, prior to the actual shift happening. So that would be very cool, because what we're expecting after 2012 is a 100 times more harmonious utopian world, where things like time travel, levitation, instant telepathy, instant healing, telekinesis are as common and as everyday as breathing.
What is at stake is more in one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order, where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause to achieve the universal aspirations of mankind: peace and security, freedom, and the rule of law.
I want to tell you about a few of the things that I have learned during these last 5 years of intensive research. Perhaps the most startling thing that I can share with you is that all of the conspiracy theories that you've ever heard about one world government, about the UN takeover of the world, all of those conspiracies have now been laid to rest. There's nothing conspiratorial about it. It's all published. The UN-funded Commission on Global Governance began meeting in 1992 in earnest and met for 4 years and last fall released their final report. It is entitled Our Global Neighborhood.
If the Bible is simply a book of myths, fairy tales, and stories, then it is disturbingly accurate in describing what we see unfolding in our current world climate. In my personal journey, I've come to the conclusion that the biblical worldview best explains the origin of evil and its many symptoms to mankind. It explains human suffering and the inescapable reality of death and decay that we experience in this world. But most importantly, it reveals why mankind has used deception as its most powerful and reliable instrument to carry out the plan set in motion by an ancient hate. Alex Jones, in his film Endgame, Blueprint for Global Enslavement, summarizes the sacred mission of the global elite as, quote, to have a two-class system where the underclass are forced to live as slaves in tiny enclosed cities, while the elite enjoy the land of the earth, evolve into superhumans with the aid of implantable technologies, live eternal lives, and travel the cosmos. This is the promise given to the inner members of the New World Order and the agenda of the Bilderberger Group, end quote. This sacred mission of the world elite has been the primary motivation for the establishments of several layers upon layers of systems in this world. The following sectors are the major components of infiltration in this plan. They include the political, economic, military, scientific, educational, technological, and social facets, with the spiritual ideologies being the main ingredient guiding this massive deception. Many of these facets overlap and build on each other. Using these various components of human society, the world elite are tirelessly working to allow the formation of a one-world currency, massive depopulation, a one-world religion, and of course, a one-world government. With the speed at which things are changing and evolving, never in human history has this plan been more attainable than today. But as I sorted through the many tentacles of this plan, I found that not only are we, the people of the world, victims, but the people who promote and continue to instigate the New World Order and the promise of a new age are perhaps the most deceived and are the ultimate victims.
The idea of what the ultimate goal for the New World Order is something that bothered me a lot in my early and really a lot of my research for what the New World Order was, as I was learning things like, you know, the stuff in the food and the water and all the stuff that you learn, you know, the genocide and the planned population reduction and the mind control and all the stuff that was going on. What did it all mean? What was it leading up to? The control grid, you know, the cameras and the one world government and the one world economy and all the stuff. What did it mean? Because the thing that got me is, What happens if they get it? You know, what happens if they finally control everybody? It's a total lockdown, New World Order, 1984, Brave New World, whatever it actually is, that system. What then? You know, is it all going to just end and everybody sits back and they drink lemonade and say, hey, we did it, guys. But then the connection to Satanism is really what started to pique my interest early on. And that they were theistic, you know, Satanists. They really did believe that Satan was God, and they actively worshipped him and received instructions from the spirit world That was what tripped me out, and to see that network and every door that was kicked down, you know, investigation led to somewhere some Satanistic connection. So the answer to what the ultimate goal and the question of who or what do I believe is behind it is the same. That is the Antichrist. The system is being built around us, the control grid, the economy, everything is being built to force everyone to worship the Antichrist. That is what this is all about. That's what makes everything make sense. It's the one component that makes everything make sense. And so what is behind it is a spiritual agenda, as it says in Ephesians 6:12, but it's also something that experientially that you can see in the research of the New World Order, that they are attending rituals, they are receiving instruction from those rituals, and that instruction is to do the nuts and bolts things, to create the system, to do this, to do the poisoning or whatever, all the different conspiracies that are a part of that have some sort of mechanism or use in this future world government, world religion, world economy, which has one purpose, isn't to extract the worship of humanity for an ancient cherub.
Tom Horn, in his book Apollyon Rising 2012, stated, quote, "Behind the scenes and beyond view of the world's uninitiated members, the alchemy and rituals of the occult masters, illuminists, masons, bonesmans, Bilderbergers, and bohemians have combined to harmonize so completely within recent U.S. foreign and domestic policies as to clearly point to a terrifying civil conjecture, a near future horizon upon which a leader of indescribable brutality will appear. Although this false prince of peace will seem at first to hold unique answers to life's most challenging questions, ultimately he will make the combined depravities of Antiochus Epiphanes, Hitler, Stalin, and Genghis Khan look like child's play."
So I really see what's going to happen there is there's going to be some person who's just born as a man, he grows up, I believe he's going to be part of the secret societies. He's going to have tremendous influence and power and access to all kinds of high-tech stuff. And among that will be the process known as recombinant DNA. And with recombinant DNA, you can actually open up a gene or a DNA strand, and you can insert a foreign gene into that. So I think what's going to happen is he's going to take Satan's DNA, Satan's genetic code, and he's going to insert it into his own body. And then he is going to become a chimera. He's going to become the beast by actually going through this transformation. The crazy thing is that we have the technology. We know that the sons of God came and did this back in the days of Noah. So we have a biblical precedence for this. And I think we're seeing these kinds of things happening already today.
To understand the biblical worldview of the New World Order, we must first look at the fall of mankind as recorded in Genesis 3. This chapter reveals the origin of the plan, who's behind it, and where it's going. No other ancient text reveals so much about the nature of evil and its methods than the Bible, and this is where it all begins. We all know the story. Adam and Eve were created by God in the Garden of Eden. God's creation was good, and mankind was very good. God had one commandment for Adam and Eve to follow. A serpent came and tempted Eve to eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. This is where it all begins. Prior to this point, mankind was not susceptible to death, but Satan had other plans. The first lie ever recorded in human history comes from the mouth of Satan himself. Satan, being the father of lies, was able to redefine what good meant. Upholding to the traits of a great deception, Satan's lie contained some truth. But to understand how this lie has permeated throughout history and is being used to create the New World Order, we must break down this passage. Satan knew that when they ate of the fruit of this tree, that mankind would be subject to death. This lie is the foundation for New Age ideas like reincarnation. It is the idea that even though we may physically die, there is no heaven or hell, but instead we return with another opportunity to attain enlightenment. It is also the one lie that many of the world elite believe today, which is that through the use of intellect, technology, and science, man will achieve immortality. This will become more obvious as we look into the sacred promise or ancient hope held close to those who are at work for the New World Order. Satan was implying here that secret knowledge and wisdom will be available to them. This is the main proponent behind the nature of secrecy which all secret societies possess. It is the idea that unattainable information will be partitioned to those who submit to the request of the one who holds the knowledge. It also plays on the hope promoted by the New Age movement, which claims that we are all spiritually evolving into a higher consciousness, and that if one would only tap into this universal energy force, they would realize that they are God. The New World Order and its components, secret societies, New Age movement, transhumanist movement, and even the alien agenda in many ways, is predicated on this one lie. The idea that man would become God is the elusive carrot on a stick that has been behind many, if not all, of man's attempts to acquire power, authority, and dominion over the masses while conquering death and nature in the process. Furthermore, we can trace ideas like pantheism and the concept that God is a force, or that everything within the universe is God and thus we are God, back to this lie. It is the ultimate deception because it plays on human pride. It is the driving force behind ideas such as morality is relative and karma. It is the denial of evil and accountability to sin. This is the core of the Luciferian doctrine. It is the blueprint to what the select group of men have been working on for centuries. Exclusive knowledge to achieve immortality and become gods, all without the help of the Creator God, but by our own use of intellect. As we will come to see, this idea, which goes by many names like the Sacred Promise and an Ancient Hope, has been sought after by men for centuries.
Here's the way they look at it. Here's their metaphor for the end of innocence. Adam and Eve were held prisoner in the Garden of Eden by an unjust, cruel, and vindictive God. Until Lucifer, through his agent Satan, set man free from this garden by giving him the gift of intellect. Through the use of intellect, man will conquer the earth, will conquer nature, and will himself become God. It's taught in every Masonic temple in this land, every secret brotherhood, every secret society, every mystical temple, every occult organization teaches the Luciferian philosophy.
When our founders declared a new order of the ages, they were acting on an ancient hope that is meant to be fulfilled.
I believe, and there's, if you read esoteric wisdom philosophers and teachers and so on, this ancient hope is the idea that there has been a plan, an ambition, contained within secret societies for thousands of years to resurrect the lost empire of Atlantis. And for those who don't know, the whole idea of the new Atlantis and the new world order and the new order of the ages are, if you read the writings of these societies, they are all one and the same thing.
The ancient hope, of which Bush refers to in his second inauguration speech, demonstrates that Bush, or at the very least the authors of his speech, are well aware of the plan initiated by an ancient occult hierarchy, now operating as secret societies to forge a world empire. The promise to those who help build this empire is that they will attain godhood themselves and become a part of a family of perfected human beings. Manly P. Hall, a 33-degree Freemason, an occultist, and regarded as one of the greatest authorities on the topic of secret societies and Freemasonry in particular, reveals in his book, The Secret Destiny of America, quote, "In this way, the old dream of the philosophic empire descended from the ancient world to modern time. Secret societies still exist, and regardless of the intemperance of the times, they will continue to flourish until the quest is complete. For more than 3,000 years, secret societies have labored to create the background of knowledge necessary to the establishment of an enlightened democracy among the nations of the world," end quote. Hall goes on to explain that America was not founded as a constitutional republic based on biblical principles, but rather a massive experiment of social engineering formed out of the principal visions described in Sir Francis Bacon's book, The New Atlantis, in 1627. The basic principle was that the goal of attaining human perfection and a utopia that would come with it is the ultimate plan put forth and worked on since antiquity. He goes on to say, quote, "The supreme human purpose is the perfection of man. This must come first, and when this end has been achieved, all good things will inevitably follow," end quote. These principles all stem back from what is known as the ancient mystery school teachings. The ancient mystery school teachings is an esoteric, spiritual wisdom and philosophy passed down by the initiated elite for centuries. It is in fact one and the same as the Luciferian doctrine that one day man will become God through the use of his own intellect. This is the religion of the New World Order, which is operating in various degrees under various secret societies, cults, and even high-ranking religious circles. The origin and understanding of the mystery schools and its history can be found in theosophical writings. Keith Thompson, in his film Aquarius, Age of Evil, does a full expose on the founding of theosophy, its connection to secret societies, the New Age movement, Zeitgeist, and ultimately the New World Order. In a document entitled The Mystery Schools, written by Grace Noach of the Theosophical Society, reveals the origin of the ancient mystery teachings. She opens the document, quote, "Millions upon millions of years ago, in the darkness of prehistory, humanity was an infant, a child of Mother Nature, unawakened, dreamlike, wrapped in the cloak of mental somnolence. Recognition of egoity slept, instinctual consciousness alone was active. Like a stream of brilliance across the horizon of time, divine beings, manas et putras, sons of mind, descended among the sleeping humans, and with the flame of intellectual solar fire lighted the wick of latent mind, and lo, the thinker stirred. Self-consciousness wakened, and man became a dynamo of intellectual and emotional power, capable of love, of hate, of glory, of defeat. Having knowledge, he acquired power. Acquiring power, he chose. Choosing, he fashioned the fabric of his future, and the perception of this ran like wine through his veins," end quote. She goes on to explain the Atlantean connection as, quote, "Time marched on and the race waxed lustily in power. As Lumeria gave birth to Atlantis, the third race to the fourth, the fiercest battle was waged. The war between the lords of light and truth and the lords of darkness and ignorance. Thus were established some 4 or 5 million years ago, when Atlantis was threatening to destroy itself through spiritual iniquity, the first mystery schools. From these early centers sprang other mystery schools in all parts of the Atlantean world. By the time the Atlanteans were in their heyday of material splendor, these schools were working their hardest to stem the increasing tide of sorcery," end quote. H.P. Blavatsky, founder of Theosophy and touted as one of the greatest writers on the topic of the occult and esoteric wisdom, stated that her book, The Secret Doctrine, is the reemergence of the ancient mystery school teachings, as quote, "The secret doctrine is the accumulated wisdom of all ages, the mysterious power of occult symbolism, that the facts which have actually occupied countless generations of initiated seers and prophets to marshal, to set down and explain in the bewildering series of evolutionary progress. It is the uninterrupted record covering thousands of generations of seers whose respective experiences were made to test and to verify the traditions passed orally by one early race to another of the teachings of higher and exalted beings who watch over the childhood of humanity," end quote. Alice Bailey, a theosophist and writer, co-founder of Lucius Trust, formerly known as Lucifer Publishing, wrote in her occult classic known as The Externalization of the Hierarchy regarding the initiation of all humanity into the ancient mystery schools as, quote, "This little-known divine energy now streams out from Shambhala. It embodies in itself the energy which lies behind the world crisis of the moment. It is the will of God to produce certain racial and momentous changes in the consciousness of the race which will completely alter man's attitude to life and his grasp of the spiritual, esoteric, and subjective essentials of living. It is this force which will bring about, in conjunction with the energy of love, that tremendous crisis imminent in the human consciousness, which we call the second crisis, the initiation of the race into the mystery of the ages, into that which has been hid from the beginning," end quote. The foundation behind all that is the ancient mystery school teachings are founded upon the idea that, once again, man was given the gift of creativity and intellect so that we ourselves can achieve godhood and become the divine beings of which we were supposed to be through the process of evolution. This idea goes directly against biblical Christianity, who offers salvation to anyone who believes in Jesus Christ. This is why the modern era writers on the topic of the ancient mysteries go to great lengths to try to discredit Christianity, and why secret societies have infiltrated its religious institutions to corrupt many sectors of Christianity, allowing historians to paint a picture of the faith which is utterly false. Most of the attempted discrediting of Christianity in these writings refer to the idea that was presented in the first section of the film Zeitgeist. In fact, it is my belief that Zeitgeist is the carrying out of what Alice Bailey referred to as the initiation of the race into the mystery of the ages. Bailey, in the same book, Externalization of the Hierarchy, goes on to describe her opinion about Christianity as, quote, "Christianity must also be overthrown because it is based on Jewish sources. The rule of Christ must come to an end because only the rule of force is right. In the world order of the Axis powers, the individual has no rights, has no freedom except insofar as he serves the state. There will be no liberty of thought or conscience. All issues will be decided by the state, and the private citizen will have no right to an opinion. Men will be drafted like slaves into the service of the state," end quote. Bailey goes on to explain the origins of Jesus, in her view, as, quote, "To this everlasting compassion, the cyclic appearance of the sun gods of the ancient myths, the world saviors, and the avatars bear witness and are the guarantee," end quote. Albert Pike shows his opinion on Christianity and morals and dogma, stating, quote, "The teachers, even of Christianity, are in general the most ignorant of the true meaning of that which they teach. There is no book of which so little is known as the Bible. To most who read it, it is as incomprehensible as the Zohar," end quote. This idea of sun worship is part of the mystery school teachings and has been the crutch of these esoteric wisdom writings in the last few centuries, attempting to explain the misunderstanding of biblical Christianity and the man of Jesus. Manly P. Hall refers to the sun in regards to Jesus, quote, "The adoration of the sun was one of the earliest and most natural forms of religious expression. From a deep philosophic consideration of the powers and principles of the sun has come the concept of the Trinity as it is understood in the world today. This orb being the symbol of all light as three distinct phases, rising, midday, and setting. The coming of the sun was hailed with joy. The time of its departure was viewed as a period to be set aside for sorrow and unhappiness. This glorious radiant orb of day, the true light which lighteth every man who cometh into the world, the supreme benefactor who raised all things from the dead, who fed the hungry multitudes, who stilled the tempest, who after dying rose again and restored all things to life. This supreme spirit of humanitarianism and philanthropy is known to Christendom as Christ, the Redeemer of worlds, and only begotten of the Father, the Word made flesh, and the hope of glory," end quote. Not surprisingly, Helena Blavatsky also refers to astronomical underpinnings of Christianity, quote, "It is useless and vain for the Protestants to explain against the Roman Catholics for their Mariolatry based on the ancient cult of lunar goddesses when they themselves worship Jehovah, preeminently a lunar god, and when both churches have accepted in their theologies the Son Christ of the Lunar Trinity," end quote. So according to these writers, which in essence is what Peter Joseph did in the first section of his film Zeitgeist, is that what Christians have been doing for centuries was actually worshiping the sun and the stars rather than God and Jesus Christ. What's interesting to note is that a single verse in the Bible can explain that this is simply not the case. In 2 Kings 23:5, it states, quote, "He did away with the pagan priests appointed by the kings of Judah to burn incense on the high places of the towns of Judah and on those around Jerusalem, those who burned incense to Baal, to the sun and moon, to the constellations, and to all the starry hosts," end quote. The ideas and opinions which permeate through society now in regards to Christianity are a residue to what we see in the esoteric writings. Even if the majority of the people who hate fundamental Christianity and religion in general are not aware of the specific assaults made by the theosophical authors, the basic attitude towards Jesus, his message, and to all Christians who believe and follow him are consistent. So who is the God of the ancient mystery schools?
The Theosophical Society is Luciferianism at its core. It is openly satanic in the case of Blavatsky, certainly Luciferianism in the case of Alice Bailey. They are exalting Lucifer. He is the God of this world, the planetary logos. He is the voice of God in the Bible, according to Alice Bailey. Lucifer is God. And I think that the New World Order philosophy and how that connects is clearly tied to Luciferianism, the exaltation of Lucifer as God, even if the lower levels of globalization and the New World Order only view that in terms of a principle. For example, the ideas of Prometheus and the light bearer and the torch and all these kinds of things, that the Garden of Eden, you know, thing was a good thing, that knowledge was given to us and by a great and awesome being. Even if they only view it as sort of allegory, that idea is Luciferianism, the exaltation of Lucifer in the Bible as a good thing, even if they don't completely view him as God. So Luciferianism is the core of theosophical philosophy, and it's also the core of the New World Order, which again makes perfect sense to the overall thesis here, that what they're doing is building up a platform to worship him.
So, you have very high-ranking guys saying that they're worshiping Lucifer. And it's not just, you know, what we might think of as kind of simple Satanism, right? Where they go and they sort of worship Satan. I mean, that's all bad, right? But it's not very classy, let's put it that way. Whereas these other guys, the Masons, they've had this secret society for a very long time. They're very focused. They're well-to-do. Got a purpose, and they're very patient. They've been working on this for a long time. And of course, everybody at the lower levels doesn't really know what's going on.
Right.
It's only when you get to the 33rd levels do you begin to understand what's going on. And even then, I think even if you get to the 33rd level, you're still somewhat deceived because you think Satan is actually the good guy.
Right.
You know? So even the guys that know everything, so to speak, are still in the dark because Satan hasn't told them his true intentions, which is he doesn't care for anybody except himself.
Ever since man realized that through special and exclusive knowledge comes power and the ability to rule over others, the ancient mystery teachings and the members who have access to this knowledge have been working in secrecy, which yields power and authority over the masses who have no idea that they are born into a highly organized, systematic society being steered towards the fulfillment of their plan. Many have been blind victims, helping continue the cycle of secrecy and deception while believing that they too were going to gain access to this knowledge.
Sir, what is your problem?
Just that, sir.
Okay.
I'm a Christian, sir.
I'm pure and virtuous and wholesome and innocent. How can you say anything about me?
Sir, you need to be born again.
I am born again.
Now, did you just say that you are Lucifer?
I am Lucifer.
Okay, define Lucifer for me.
Pure, virtuous, wholesome, innocent individual that's out to help people.
Lucifer is?
Yeah.
Say that again. Lucifer is a pure, holy...
Virtuous.
Virtuous. Now, see the Lucifer that God created?
That's the same one.
Oh, man, this is great. I'm going to put this on the internet.
Oh,
amen.
God bless you,
amen.
Brother.
Because that's exactly what the Shriners and Masons teach, is that Lucifer is light.
Sir.
Jesus said, many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not do these good deeds in your name? And you'll say, away from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you.
Jesus said it?
In Matthew chapter 5.
Mercy.
No.
That's hard to believe.
So you're a Christian and you don't know that. Actually,
no, I really am.
You are.
Because I'm pure and virtuous.
You're pure and virtuous, okay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you're perfect without Jesus, right?
No.
Okay, tell me about Jesus. Who is Jesus?
Well, he's my leader.
Is he the Son of God?
Yes, he is.
Is he the only worshipful master?
Yes.
Have you ever been called worshipful master?
No, because I've just been too busy. I've been working.
Get out of here.
See, this is what a Mason confesses, is that Lucifer is light.
Yale University is 300 years old this year, and were you to visit its campus, you would see that it still has exotic clubhouses, which look like tombs where Yale's legendary secret societies meet. Their prestige and importance have largely evaporated, but the rituals are still a secret. And so when we heard that some enterprising characters had managed to spy on the famous Skull and Bone Society, we couldn't resist. Here's ABC's Dan Harris.
The videotape provides a grainy glimpse into what appear to be the initiation rituals of a secret society that's been around since 1832, whose members have gone on to be leaders of Wall Street and the White House, the Senate and the Supreme Court.
They're sort of trying to scare the initiates, make them disorient them, frighten them.
New York Observer investigative reporter Ron Rosenbaum accompanied a team of Yale students who shot these pictures 9 days ago. Rosenbaum's curiosity about Skull and Bones was permanently piqued when, as a classmate of George W. Bush, he lived right next to the tomb, the group's heavily fortified home. From their perch, Rosenbaum and his cohorts taped the tomb's courtyard. What they captured, they say, was initiates, known as neophytes, being forced to kiss a skull. Then members performing a mock killing.
There is a biblical explanation for the ancient mystery schools and the idea of resurrecting Atlantis. After the fall of mankind in the garden, God says something very interesting to Satan. This is the first prophecy recorded in the Bible. Her seed pertains to the coming Messiah who would free humanity from the bondage of sin of which Satan deceived humanity into accepting. It is also foreshadowing the virgin birth, since women are not the ones who carry the seed. This coming Messiah would bruise thy head, meaning he would defeat Satan and his work. God also mentions thy seed and how he will only bruise thy heel. This is the seed of Satan. Thus, the countermove for Satan became clear. Disrupt the human genetic pool so that the pure bloodline of man will not bring forth the Messiah to redeem mankind. This is the reason for the flood. We find the account of this attempt to disrupt the human genetic code in Genesis 6. It reads, quote, "When man began to multiply on the face of the land and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were attractive, and they took as their wives any they chose. Then the Lord said, My spirit shall not abide in man forever, for he is flesh. His days shall be 120 years. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of man, and they bore children to them. These were the mighty men who were of old, the men of renown." End quote. The sons of God mentioned here in the Hebrew is pronounced B'nai Ha-Elohim. The Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the original Hebrew text, translates it as angels of God. They are clearly describing fallen angels. We know this because the Bible confirms this in 2 Peter 2:4, where it states, quote, "For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment, end quote. And in Jude 1:6, where it states, quote, and the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day, end quote. Programs like Ancient Aliens on the History Channel have attempted to describe these sons of God as being aliens from outer space. This is wishful thinking. The reality is that these fallen angels were rebels to God and not some race of aliens from a faraway galaxy. In fact, the whole idea that there might be an alien race from outer space is part of the New World Order deception. We will get back to the UFO and an alien phenomenon a little bit later, but for now let's continue on with what the Bible says about these sons of God.
What the passage portrays, and it's very difficult for many people to absorb this, it portrays fallen angels. These are not the good guys. Remember when Satan fell, a third of the angels fell with him. Not all of them, but a group of them, apparently, and we'll talk more about this in a minute, chose to try to create a hybrid race by cohabiting. I don't know the technology. I'm not going to get into that. But they apparently angels can't multiply. Angels are eternal. Reproduction is a process for mortals. But at the same time, Satan's got a problem. A third of the angels fell with him, so he's got a deficiency of 2-to-1 in any war that comes in, right? He's got to find a way to strengthen himself. This is just a conjecture that floats around. Now, the offspring are Nephilim. They're also called the Hagibarim, the mighty ones. Now, where the confusion starts to set in is when this Hebrew passage was translated into the Greek in the Septuagint, the word they used for the Nephilim was gigantes. It sounds like giants, and it turns out they were giants, but that's not what the word means. Gigantes comes from gigas, which means earthborn. So in the Hebrew, they're called the fallen ones. In the Greek, they're called the earthborn. The purpose of the flood was not just that there was sin in the land. There was, and that's emphasized. But if sin brings the flood, we better get some life jackets. No, there's something far deeper going on. That's what I want to sensitize you for when you do your own study and come to your own conclusions. But I want you to recognize there's something much more profound that's a problem that God was solving. And that is that Satan's strategy was to contaminate the human race.
Now that we know who these sons of God were, let's make the connection with the ancient mystery teachings. In order to do this, we must turn to a book which is referenced in the New Testament by Jesus, Peter, Paul, and Jude, but are not in the current Bible as we have today. It is also a book that the early church fathers considered inspired, and certainly the audience of the early Israelites were well versed in and familiar with. I am speaking about the Book of Enoch. I believe it is important to look at a book like Enoch and enhance our understanding of the Bible. I am not ready to say that it is inspired canon, but if it is referenced by so many in the New Testament, I believe it is worth investigating. The modern-day Christian scholars have largely put the Book of Enoch aside. As such, the book has been used by people who promote the ancient alien idea and folks like Zachariah Sitchin to present their theories of Nibiru and the Anunnaki. But in fact, the biblical foundation is the best fit for the Book of Enoch. So let's look at what it says. The first thing which is very interesting about the Book of Enoch is found in the beginning of the text. It states, quote, I heard everything from them, and I understood what I saw, not for this family, but for a remote generation, one that is to come, end quote. It is interesting to note that the remnants of several almost complete copies of the Book of Enoch in Aramaic were found among the Dead Sea Scrolls in the middle of the 20th century. Furthermore, it is somewhat eerie to think that Enoch states the book is meant for future generations in light of what Jesus said of what will be the time of his return when he stated, quote, as the days of Noah were, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. This statement by Jesus will become more and more relevant as we continue to investigate what the days of Noah were like. The Book of Enoch tells us several things, such as the number of fallen angels or watchers as they are referred, where they landed, and what they taught mankind. It even lists the names of 20 of the fallen angels. But as it pertains to the mystery schools, it is very interesting the kinds of things that these watchers taught humanity. It states, quote, Azazel taught them to make swords, knives, shields, and breastplates, and made known to them metals and the skill of working them for bracelets and jewelry. Azazel also taught the use of antimony for coloring the eyelids, along with all types of precious stones and dye formulas. From this arose great disobedience. They were led astray. They committed immorality. They became corrupt in all their ways. Semyaza taught cursing and root cutting. Armeros, curse lifting. Barakoyel taught star signs. Kokabel, star patterns. Ezekiel, cloud lore. Arakiel, land signs. Shamziel, sun signs. And Sariel, moon pathways. End quote. According to the Book of Enoch, this is the origin of the mystery schools. The fallen angels taught mankind weapon making and warfare, applying makeup and jewelry, introduced mankind to psychedelic drugs, vampirism, enchantments, and cursings, as well as astrology. It is quite remarkable to see how much of what these watchers taught not only relate to the ancient mystery religions, but are common everyday things of the world we live in today. We even see the watchers teach mankind the art of abortion. Quote, the fifth was Kasdea. This is he who showed the Yaladim Aam all the evil strikings of unclean Rakim and demonic entities. He showed them the dashing of the embryo in the womb so that it would die. End quote. The Book of Enoch also states that the watchers began to mix animals and humans together. Quote, they started to sin against birds, beasts, reptiles, fish, and then to devour one another's bodies, even drinking the blood. It was then the earth laid accusation against these lawless ones. End quote. The Book of Jasher, another ancient text referenced several times in the Bible, which also records the nefarious acts of the fallen angels, confirms, quote, then the sons of men began teaching the mixture of animals of one species with the other, in order therewith to provoke the Lord, end quote. This is extremely interesting because it is information which would have sounded absurd until the last half century. It is not talking about hybridization, but of creating creatures that go beyond their own kind as God created man, animals, and plants. This tells us a couple of things. One, that the technology they had was far greater than we can ever imagine. This is confirmed in the Book of Ecclesiastes in the Bible, where it states, quote, what has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun, end quote. No matter how far we think we've come in the name of science and technology, it seems we are only catching up to what we were taught by these fallen angels in the antediluvian or pre-flood world. Two, the creatures we see in several ancient mythologies such as centaurs and minotaurs could all be attributed from what these fallen angels did on the earth. Steve Quayle, in his book Genesis 6 Giants, summarizes this idea, stating, quote, the collective memories in the form of myths, fables, and fairy tales from various cultures and ages of mankind are overwhelming evidence that the Nephilim existed, end quote. I believe that the antediluvian world of fallen angels, hybrids, warfare, Nephilim, astrology, advanced technology, and false spirituality is Atlantis. As theosophists and esoteric authors of the last century wrote how they believe the mystery schools began in Atlantis, I believe that the antediluvian world and the teachings of these fallen angels are the same thing. This makes sense to what the elite and secret societies are trying to do to forge a new world order today. Not only are they trying to rediscover Atlantis, but in doing so, they are merely attempting to fulfill the ancient hope which has been at work since the days of Adam and Eve, the earthly rule of the Antichrist. The truth certainly seems stranger than fiction.
and even jaded New Yorkers scratching their heads. A mysterious, silver, shiny object, or objects, it seems, floating in the sky yesterday. You can see all people have stopped in the street there in their tracks looking at it. Some folks say they saw lights. Others were maybe waiting for little green men to arrive.
It says Centerville abuzz tonight, a bright blue light spotted moving in the sky.
And here's what you captured, this bright, fiery light moving across the sky.
Surveyors say they found what can only be described as the wreckage of a crashed spaceship.
That's getting real bright.
Stacey Gibson can't tell you what she captured on home video, but she can tell you she's never seen anything.
You gotta see it for yourself. These residents saw the light hovering in the sky about Monday night.
A North Canton couple is trying to figure out what it was that they saw in the sky over their home just a few days ago. Mysterious, unexplained, orange-colored objects.
Karen, they tell us that they saw lights, but those lights were not from an airplane or a helicopter, and these lights dropped something as they hung low over the sky.
Mike was in the Air Force and says the lights hovering in the sky were unlike any he had seen.
What is that? The flaming noise produced in the cell phone with one of the espantados ligaram para tudo.
Siete las esferas que lograron verse en el centro de Lima, en lugares como el de la Avenida España.
One of the main topics of interest the New Age movement has harnessed through the infiltrating of the Truth Movement has been on the topic of UFOs and ETs. Many of these folks, like David Wilcock, David Icke, Jordan Maxwell, and many others, have in fact verified the concept that the UFO phenomenon is not necessarily flesh and blood beings, but are a race of highly evolved spiritual entities who have attained what we refer to as godhood and power over the elements of nature and physics of which we are currently limited to. This is eerily similar to the sacred promise given to the inner members of the New World Order. It is also the same concept being promoted by transhumanists and the road to attain singularity and human immortality through the use of technology in the field of biology and genetics. I believe that all of these various tentacles are leading to the same place and the same goal, More people today believe that there is life outside of Earth than ever before. A 2008 Scripps UFO poll conducted by Thomas Hargrove and Guido H. Stample showed that over 74% of 18 to 24-year-olds believed it was likely that intelligent life exists on other planets. This is perhaps due to several factors, including our current growth in scientific knowledge and understanding of the size and vastness of the universe, but also the propaganda perpetuated by our media. Science fiction has exploded in America and the world as a staple theme for films, movies, books, and video games. Could this all be part of the plan to prepare the world for disclosure?
I think the New Age, as well as the mainstream sort of media, and I mean like movies and television shows, and everybody's been shoving this alien UFO thing down our throats because it has so many uses for the Antichrist system. I've said many times, I don't know if this is the way that it will all be set up. It is just a really convenient way if it does go down like this, because it does do three main things that are needed for the Antichrist system. Number one, it causes the world to reject God. We've been sold this erroneous idea that if aliens exist, then God doesn't. So the headlines the day after would read, you know, God proven wrong or whatever. The whole world would be united in its rejection of God overnight. So that certainly would play in, obviously, to the biblical account of this world order at the end of time. Also, we would believe ourselves to be God. This one would take a little bit longer to sink in, but the idea that aliens, in a real sort of evolution kind of way, just evolved, and that it could be sold to us that they were somehow our creators in the sense that they genetically modified us, or they might have some excuse to the origin of life or something to that effect. Ultimately, we would see them as gods in the sense of their perhaps abilities or their technological advancement, and it really depends on this point of how and what they say about us, if they say anything, or if in the discovering of them that it is implied in some way that that we ourselves could be like them and therefore like gods. And that really goes into the third part, which is the evolution. I think that this concept of evolution is crucial to so much of what the Antichrist system does, especially the genocide based on belief system that happens in the end time scenario, really requires, as it did in the Third Reich, an idea of evolution. There's a concept that there's certain people that are not fit for the new system, the new evolution. They were sort of helping humanity evolve by the elimination of those that weren't ready for the new age, the new world. Hitler believed in the fifth root race of Blavatsky, but yet I think this new system is going to have a very unique version of evolution. And of course, the appearance of aliens really validates that on a worldwide scale. No longer do you have to, have this sort of underground preaching of theosophy as it was in Hitler's time, but rather the whole world is united in this understanding or perceived understanding of potential evolution coming. After all, the aliens are here. We can be like them. They just simply evolved like we have the potential to do. We can become like them. We can communicate telepathically or whatever, as long as we are willing to take that next step. And there's this great precipice that we're, now at this ability to move to this next level, but it's all going to be in the context of, God has just recently been disproven, but yet there'll be people on Earth that can't quite go with the new system because they're stuck in the old paradigm of God does exist and the Bible was accurate and these aliens are a deception. Those people will be presented as enemy number one and will be viewed as the thing that's holding us back from the potential evolution.
UFOs and ETs in the Bible? Interesting question. We got to define our terms a little bit, I think, right? So, in as far as there were sons of God coming down, there were demons coming down, then yes, there are aliens, because the demons of yesterday are today's aliens. That's really the bottom line. There are not aliens from some distant galaxy or from the Pleiades system or anything like that. They are very much from here. They're demonic. And so, in as far as there were demons, then yes. But, we can't call them demons or gods from yesteryear because that's really out of fashion. Right. But you can call them aliens because now they're from some other place and they evolved. It's interesting how evolution has served as such a foundation for this. Mm-hmm. You know, God, I mean, the demons, Satan gets us thinking that there is no God, that there is so no Satan or any demons. But then he starts replacing it with these other entities. And we believe in evolution, you know, lots of people do. And so that serves as the foundation for these otherworldly beings that have also evolved, not by God, mind you. But they've evolved from a long time ago. And as far as UFOs, well, a UFO is an unidentified flying object. And we're seeing those today. People are seeing those all over the place. And generally what they look like is just some kind of a white light. It's a white ball of light or something like this that's floating around in the sky. And people will say, oh, it's a kite. Now, we can all see what a kite looks like. They're not helicopters. We know what helicopters look like. We're not stupid, right? Neither are the people that take all these videos. And you can watch them on YouTube, and there's just thousands of them. And, you know, I'm sure there's a few pranksters out there, right? But sure, but still, just the quantity and even the quality of the video is such that you're like, wow, that's really amazing. So in the Old Testament, you find places where the heavens were opened. For example, in 2 Kings chapter 6, Elijah and his servant are surrounded by the Syrians. They wake up one morning and the servant goes outside and he sees all these guys. He's like, oh boy. He goes back and says, Master, we're done. And Elijah, you know, he's just very calm and he prays, oh Lord, I pray you'd open his eyes. And so God opens the young man's eyes and he looks all around him and he sees these horses and chariots of fire. Now that's interesting. Why would God need to use chariots of fire? Well, I don't know the answer. I mean, you'd think you could just go, you know, kind of Star Trek kind of thing. You know, just you go from here to there. But for some reason, in that other dimension, you have horses of fire, you got these chariots of fire, and these things are going around. And in some way, I would suspect that the demons are kind of doing the same thing. I don't know if they're on horses of fire necessarily, but when they materialize, they look like these fiery white orbs. And you know, however they're transporting themselves, I don't know. But it's not like they can just think it and they're there, but they have to somewhat travel, they have to traverse through whatever medium, the spiritual medium or through the physical medium, they're actually moving about. So, again, I wouldn't say that we have, you know, what we call technical UFOs back then, but you did have these horses and chariots of fire in that angelic spiritual realm. There's movement going on. Angels have wings. Again, why would they have wings? Right? Is there air in that? These are questions we just don't know.
Right.
You know, we just don't know the answer to these things. But still, there's a function for these things. If they have wings, then they must need them. If there are horses and chariots of fire, then they must need those in some capacity that I don't understand. And we're not really told. But still, there it is. So, what we're seeing today is a resurgence. We're seeing a breakthrough of that realm into our own. And those demons are coming through. Somehow they're being able to manifest in this realm. I don't know how they do that, but they're doing it. They're manifesting, and they're up in the skies. I mean, millions of people have seen these things.
Right.
You even have sort of more famous people like Ronald Reagan. Mm-hmm. He claimed to have seen something a number of times. Jimmy Carter, Barry Goldwater, Douglas MacArthur. All right, just to name a few of the presidents. You have other world leaders. You have Michio Kaku, who's a real famous physicist.
Let me make a prediction. And that is sometime by mid-century, we might make contact with an intelligent civilization in outer space.
Plus you have, you know, just lots and lots of astronauts. They say that every time that we had a mission, we were being followed by something. We were being watched. We saw some craft. We saw something. Right? And you can watch some of these videos that have been released by NASA, and you can see these things out there, right? So there's definitely something out there. The question is, what is it?
Scholars with no religious affiliation who have looked into this topic of UFOs and ETs for several decades have come to very interesting conclusions. Jack Vallée, a venture capitalist, computer scientist, author, ufologist, and former astronomer who helped build the precursor to what we know as the internet, has studied the UFO phenomenon for over three decades. After looking into the relationship between UFOs, cults, religious movements, demons, angels, ghosts, and psychic phenomenon, Vallée changed his proposed hypothesis from the UFO phenomenon being an extraterrestrial origin, in other words, craft and beings from another planet or a faraway galaxy, to a multidimensional visitation hypothesis, or interdimensional. In his book, Messengers of Deception, Vallée states, quote, "Human beings are under the control of a strange force that bends them in absurd ways, forcing them to play a role in a bizarre game of deception," end quote. Later in the same book, he states, quote, "The UFO phenomenon represents a manifestation of a reality that transcends our current understanding of physics. The UFOs are physical manifestations that cannot be understood apart from their psychic and symbolic reality. What we see in effect here is not an alien invasion, it is a control system which acts on humans and uses humans," end quote. J. Allen Hynek, a U.S. astronomer, professor, and ufologist, best remembered for his contributions in the field of UFOs and acting as scientific advisor to UFO studies taken by the U.S. Air Force, again came to same conclusions of the UFOs and alleged extraterrestrial phenomenon. In his book, Edge of Reality, he states, quote, "If UFOs are somebody else's nuts and bolts hardware, then we must still explain how such tangible hardware can change shape before our eyes, vanish in a Cheshire cat manner, not even leaving a grin, seemingly melt away in front of us, or apparently materialize mysteriously before us without apparent detection by persons nearby or in neighboring towns. We must wonder, too, where UFOs are hiding when not manifesting themselves to human eyes," end quote. The overall consensus seems to be that these crafts which are being seen have the ability to manifest as physical objects and at the same time manipulate time and space as to become invisible or perform aerial maneuvers that defy our current understanding of physics and nature. The deeper side to this phenomenon are the abduction accounts recorded by millions of people all over the world, regardless of time, race, culture, and upbringing. Dr. John Mack, professor at Harvard Medical School, a psychiatrist and writer, also looked into the UFO and abduction phenomenon for several decades and came to similar conclusions as Vallée and Hynek. Although he recently passed away, his contributions to the study of ufology and alien abductions is highly touted and greatly respected. He states in an interview with Nova Online when asked if the phenomenon is literally physical or psychological, stating, quote, "Yes, it's both. It's both literally physically happening to a degree, and it's also some kind of psychological, spiritual experience occurring and originating perhaps in another dimension. And so the phenomenon stretches us, or it asks us to stretch to open to realities that are not simply the literal physical world, but to extend to a possibility that there is other unseen realities from which our consciousness, our, if you will, learning processes, over the past several hundred years have closed us off," end quote.
So what seems to be the case is they come from some other domain, some place, maybe not another star or maybe from another dimension, but they manifest, they show up here in our physical world.
People have a number of cases where people are just plain gone. A child comes into the mother's room, "Mom, you weren't there during the night when I came." There is burned earth outside where the ships have landed. There is physical, it may not satisfy our criteria of proof, but proof may be something which only operates within the frame of evidence of this physical world in the box you mentioned before,
right,
that we live in. This is what's going on here is something in some ways more subtle. In other words, something that's coming from another dimension into our world, which is very commonly experienced in other cultures, but not in this culture.
John Mack, who recently passed away, but he was at Harvard. And according to his own testimony, he says and I was not a believer in this thing. He wasn't trying to prove anything. He just kept hearing about these things. So he came to this conclusion that these were real physical abductions. Very, very slowly he came to that conclusion. And rather skeptically, he didn't want to come to that conclusion. But eventually the data was so much that he could not overcome it. And he had to just say, well, it's happening. Something physical is happening. Dr. David Jacobs has done similar research. He was quite upbeat about this whole thing for a long time. But in the last several years, he's become very downcast about his discoveries, because he's discovering that these beings that are taking people are smarter than us, they're stronger than us, and they have a hybridization program going on. Right. That they're creating a hybrid race to take over, and he says at best we're going to be second-class serfs. So he's very discouraged, and I can see why. You know, I think if you discover these things, and yet you don't understand that there's a greater power, which is Jesus Christ, who has a much better plan, then I would be extremely depressed. You know, I mean, and in a way, I'm sort of upbeat about the whole thing because I see that we are getting very close to the end. Right. But it's also kind of scary. I mean, there's just crazy things going on.
Dr. David Jacob, an associate professor of history at Temple University, specializing in 20th century American history and culture, has also studied the UFO and abduction phenomenon for over 40 years. In an interview with L.A. Marzulli in the book Alien Interviews, Jacobs comments on the alien abduction phenomenon, stating, quote, "This is a phenomenon that is either psychological or it is happening. There is very little in the middle. I have learned that the abduction phenomenon is vast, global, and it occurs with great frequency," end quote. Whitley Strieber, in his classic account of an alien encounter in the book Communion, records his experience with these entities, stating, quote, "I became entirely given over to extreme dread. The fear was so powerful that it seemed to make my personality become evaporate. Whitley ceased to exist. What was left was a body in a state of raw fear so great that it swept about me like a thick, suffocating curtain, turning paralysis into a condition that seemed close to death. I died and a wild animal appeared in my place," end quote. Then in a later release in a book entitled Transformation, The Breakthrough, he dives deeper into the experience, stating, quote, "Increasingly, I felt as if I were entering a struggle that might even be more than life and death. It might be a struggle for my soul, my essence, or whatever part of me might have reference to the eternal. There are worse things than death, I suspected. So far, the word demon has never been spoken among the scientists and doctors who were working with me. Alone at night, I worried about the legendary cunning of demons. At the very least, I was going stark, raving mad," end quote. Then later in the same book, he states, quote, "I felt an absolutely indescribable sense of menace. It was hell on earth to be there in the presence of these entities. And yet I couldn't move, couldn't cry out, couldn't get away. I lay as still as death, suffering inner agonies. Whatever was there seemed so monstrously ugly, so filthy and dark and sinister. Of course they were demons, they had to be, and they were here and I couldn't get away," end quote. According to many researchers in the field, and even the people who have directly experienced this phenomenon for themselves, all seem to agree that there is a spiritual element driving this phenomenon. It is clear that there is a metaphysical nature to the UFOs and the alien abductions themselves. Furthermore, the startling similarities with the phenomenon with the occult and other historical, mythological accounts of direct contact with demonic entities should be alarming. Jack Vallée alludes to this concept, stating, quote, "The symbolic display seen by the abductees is identical to the type of initiation ritual or astral voyage that is embedded in the occult traditions of every culture. The structure of abduction stories is identical to that of occult initiation rituals. The UFO beings of today belong to the same class of manifestation as the occult entities that were described in centuries past," end quote. There is another angle to this phenomenon that is seldom discussed, but is very important to point out. That is the solution to help stop those who experience the alien abduction phenomenon. Joe Jordan, state-sanctioned director and field investigator for MUFON, through his investigation at CE4 Research Group, has discovered that calling upon the name of Jesus Christ during the abduction can make the experience stop instantly. On their website, ce4research.com, the mission statement states, quote, "The mission of CE4 Research Group is to share with the world the most powerful evidence known that exposes the alien entities for who they really are. The evidence is in the testimony of those who have overcome the experience, the oppression, the bondage, the harassment, the control, the lies, the deception that these entities perpetuate by calling out in the name and authority of Jesus Christ. Through this evidence of these testimonies, we will be able to help others. The world asks for this evidence, and we will give it to them." End quote.
A lot of the people that have seen my videos know my testimony of how it all started with one book. On a vacation trip to visit my brother, I picked up one book, UFO Crash at Roswell, and it was like opening a doorway into something that would totally change my life. And it has, and it's changed a number of times since then, but that one started it. It put me on a quest to find out what this UFO phenomenon was about. And like I said, I came into it as an agnostic with an open mind and what I thought was total objectivity, and became a MUFON investigator. Was doing UFO investigations, sighting investigations for a few years, and then got caught up in what is called the New Age belief system and metaphysical studies, because, you know, it's part of this UFO phenomenon. It goes hand in hand. I was caught up in all of that too, and it changed my worldview again, from being, you know, an agnostic humanist to one who was into the New Age and actually practicing these metaphysical studies myself. And I was able to see the UFO phenomenon through another set of eyes. And then in 1996, I was shown the true gospel, where it actually caught my attention, and I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior in November of 1996. And now I was able to look at this phenomenon in yet another set of eyes. So initially, was this what I was looking for? No, it was not. Well, the first case I came across, I actually had interviewed this gentleman who claimed to have had an abduction experience, along with other sighting experiences and other, what he felt were abduction experiences too. But we decided to interview him, and this was 6 months before I became a Christian. This was in the middle of 1996 that we did the interview with him. And I used to come to my monthly meetings, my MUFON meetings that I had, and he just wanted to share what he had been through, you know, and he was had an interest because of his experiences in the UFO phenomena. And myself and one of my lead investigators, actually my partner that helped me found CE4 in the very beginning, his name was Wes Clark. He was a very good investigator, worked for the Space Center at the time as a quality inspector. And he had a good organizational skill of helping do these investigations. And him and I interviewed this gentleman in his home for 2 hours on videotape, and just let him talk, and we asked some questions and would guide him along just to try to get all of his information. Well, we put it away, and we didn't see anything unusual at the time, and that was interesting in itself that we didn't catch this. But when I became a believer in November of 96, I was ready to put all of this away, because God showed me what this UFO experience was about, that there was a evil demonic side to it. And I felt that as a new Christian and wanting to do the things that God asked of me, that we shouldn't be involved in this, and I'd put it away. And God says, no, I got plans for you, and you need to take this message back to, you know, where you came from. And I said, you know, I can't take the word of God back to these New Age people. I said, they don't believe it to be the inerrant word of God. As a matter of fact, they don't even believe in God being a personal, you know, being, an entity that they can relate to. So I said, you got to give me something better. And nobody told me that as a new Christian, you don't talk to God like that. But I did, not knowing any better. And he answered, and he says, guess what? You already have it. you just haven't seen it. And I couldn't understand what that meant at first. So I asked my partner, Wes, who was a Christian at the time, I said, we've got something here somewhere that we need to go back and look at. We went back and looked at some of the cases that we had, and we pulled this particular one back out. It was a gentleman named Bill D. We pulled his video back out, plugged it into the VCR, and sat back and started watching and went, oh my. Do you remember hearing this? And Wes says, I don't. And we were sitting right there watching the gentleman and listening to him. But yet we were blinded and deafened at the time we did the recording.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing registered until this time when God said, go back and look, you already have it. And what he shared was an experience, atypical, abduction type experience, where he had been taken, experienced being taken, and immediately panicked and in fear. And he himself, actually just being a brand new Christian, called out during this panic experience in saying, Jesus, Jesus, help me. And when he did that, in an instant, the experience abruptly stopped. And he felt like he was thrown back into his bed. He even startled his wife. She asked him why he was jumping on the bed. And he said, you know, when he shared that experience, he didn't understand what it meant. And when we heard that, we knew we had something. Because never before, in all the studies we had done of the other work that the top researchers had done in the country, you know, this was 15 years ago, the big names, never before had anybody said that an experience could be stopped. As a matter of fact, they all said that it wasn't possible to stop an experience.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But yet we had a gentleman that said he did, and in a particular way. So I contacted these top researchers around the country, got their home phones, called them up. They're nice guys. They can talk. You can talk to them just like me and you were talking. Most of them are very nice gentlemen. And I've met them at the conferences over the years. And I said, guys, I've got a very unusual case here. I'd like to run it by you and see what you think. And after I share the story, they all asked, can we go off the record? And I said, well, that's fine. I said, I'm just trying to get answers here. Well, when I say go off the record, that means I can't tell you who said what, but I can tell you what they said. Well, these guys, they said that, yes, we had come across similar cases where people had cried out in the name of Jesus or had quoted scripture or had sung a Christian hymn, and the experience stopped. And I said, really? And I said, first off, I've never read anywhere where you guys have said that an experience can even be stopped. And then second, I've never read where you've stated where they could be stopped in any type of manner like this. And I said, why is that? And one of two answers, or both answers, would come out from each of these researchers. The first one was pretty common amongst them, was we didn't know what to make of it. But you know what? I would have been fine with that, because to me, that was an honest answer. I mean, I didn't know what to make of it either in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
So I could relate to them on that answer. But they always would follow it with a second answer. And it was, we were afraid to go there, meaning the spiritual side of this,
mm-hmm.
because it might affect our credibility in the UFO realm. So what I was seeing is they had research evidence, part of the UFO puzzle that we've all been trying to put together, but they chose not to share it because of it affecting their credibility. Not that it was getting to the truth or it was completing an entire puzzle, but because of personal issues, personal agendas. And you know what that's called? It's called a cover-up. Throughout the UFO community, you hear government cover-up this, government cover-up that. But I'm telling you from experience in dealing with this type of case that there's been a cover-up all along. by the researchers in this UFO community phenomenon that are supposedly giving us the truth and the answers to this experience. It's coming from them because they've got personal agendas. They only want to share certain things. You know, and if you ever follow these conferences that are going on out there, it's like they never give you the whole thing. You know, you get little bits and pieces. And I guess it's part of keeping you busy coming to their conferences. You know, but I've been sharing the same message for years now, the same evidence, and it still disturbs them.
There are several testimonies on CE4Research.com, and I encourage anyone who has either been affected by the phenomenon or knows someone who has to take a look at this research. It is much too important not to. In an article on HearkenTheWatchman.com entitled Demons or Extraterrestrials Tremble at the Name of Jesus Christ, Dr. Stephen Ulish comes to the same conclusion, stating, quote, I believe in UFOs and extraterrestrials. I do not believe that either I am delusional or am I hallucinating. I do believe that the government is covering up these phenomena even though they are being bewitched as to its real meaning. This deception is part of the spiritual war between God and Satan. These are therefore serious topics, end quote.
We have crossed the Pleiadians, and as we've said, it is our pleasure to be here at this time to communicate with you, to give you an opportunity to understand our energy and who we are. This one that speaks through us, we call her our vehicle. She has given you